conference is not easy. I always assume that it's not very easy. So, welcome again. My name is Andrei Costin. I'm a PhD. I'm a doctor in computer security, specializing in embedded security in particular. And today I'll be talking about hacking the Internet of Things. Let me first try to introduce the embedded devices. How many of you know the embedded devices, have been playing with them? So I assume that everybody of you at least once had to deal with some kind of embedded device, except your smartphone, of course, which is the most ubiquitous, but you'd had to set up your home router, which is the most common embedded device, and maybe you had to print some pages, which is another second largest embedded device, or maybe you set up a CCTV camera in your home to watch for your pets. But to get to my point of more technical things, I want to first give you an overview of what I've been doing lately so you understand why I focused on embedded devices and actually how we reached to the important things. So in 2009, I started doing some RFID security research, and maybe some of you know the MyFair Classic cards or the RFID cards sometimes used in London Oyster card or some other transportation or metro cards. I'm not sure. In Spain, in Madrid, apparently they are, but not all of them are. MyFair Classic. And the idea is that, I'm not sure if you can see the mouse pointer, but in general, it's an embedded device because it has like a very small circuit here which implements some logic, and of course it has some vulnerabilities. And if you are interested, maybe some of your university cards are RFID based, maybe MyFair Classic. If you go and pay with your card at the cafeteria, maybe you can put some money on it, or don't do this. But the tools are here, so I started working with the embedded devices from RFID field. Then I moved to the printer security in 2010-2011. I've been studying the different security vulnerabilities in printers for a couple of years. I've been showing that since 2010-2011, even much before nowadays, there were thousands of printers. As you can see, there is like a map of printers being available online. You could print to anybody of these printers, or even you can hack them, which is even worse. But then in 2012, basically, I did a little bit of airplane air traffic security. And as you imagine, the airplane and all this air infrastructure also has, at some point, this kind of small devices which take input from radio frequency and try to do some things with it. And this is all thanks to embedded devices again, because the same as your car, the same is the airplane. It has a lot of embedded devices inside, and it has to communicate with the tower, with the airport. And again, we see that there's different kind, but still embedded devices, different shape. It's not your usual computer with keyboard and display. And then in 2013, I did like a thorough research on CCTV in DVR security. And how many of you had played with CCTV systems and DVRs and tried to set up at home or at least watch your neighbor or things like that, right? So I did some research in 2013, and back then it was striking that you could, even then, 3 years ago, you could find high population of this kind of CCTV and DVR cameras online. And why is that? Because except for the routers who are needed, which are needed to be connected to the internet directly to make your home connection available, the next biggest population of connected devices on the internet are, okay, except smartphones and so on, which goes over your telecom network, are the CCTV cameras or DVRs. Why? Because you usually put this CCTV camera or DVRs in your home or in your enterprise or in your business, right? and you want to access from your office or from around the globe to see what's going on home to make sure your home is safe. So usually this is the first device you want to connect directly to the internet. That's the purpose. Other devices may be a smart TV or smart fridge you don't want to connect directly to the internet, but this one you explicitly want to connect to the internet. And it was interesting to find that there were like 1 or 2 million of this kind of systems back in 2013 available on the internet. Not all of them, of course, are vulnerable or insecure, but many of them have default passwords, and some of them had different backdoor vulnerabilities. You have all these links in the presentation, and I do hope that you take time and go through the links, because there is a lot of material under each link, and you read, but it's kind of a quick summary. And for example, after we presenting these kind of details and queries, if you would go to this link, there's a list of queries you can run on Shodan. How many of you know Shodan? It's kind of a Google for hackers. Yeah, it's advertised like that. It's like a search engine which enables you to find different, not websites, but devices, okay? So is Shodan is this kind of thing. So here you will find these queries which I created in 2013 to find these 1 or 2 million. And you could see that some people quickly understood the potential of these vulnerabilities in these kind of devices, or abuse or misuse. So in 2014, 1 year later, or a few months later, some anonymous person just quickly took these kind of queries, maybe created some of his own or her own, and created a website which was hitting the news, and it's called Insecam, right? Insecam comes obviously from insecure cameras. And these are not the web cameras which you normally would look into a city hall or forever. It's not like public webcams, it's like private webcams which are put, for example, I'm not sure if you can see, but these are stacks of money, okay? And some calculator, and this is McDonald's, okay? So this is one example, okay? And these kinds of cameras are you could access from airports, and if you go to this website, you could find cameras from Girona, okay? And maybe some of you will recognize the bars you go into, or the cafes, and those are not public webcams, again. Those are private, okay? But you could still find this. So it was like the first example of taking these kind of vulnerable systems or not very well protected from online and showing the privacy impact, okay? This was the privacy attack because it invaded the privacy. It didn't do anything bad with these cameras, but it just show you how creepy it can be, and if you have such a camera, then of course you don't want everybody to look what you do in your home or bedroom or kitchen, right? But then in 2016, 2 years later, it took some time for the people to realize the potential of having these few hundred thousand cameras or a million of cameras or devices, easy to access, and you could see, for example, I'm not sure if you can see easily, but it's admin and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yesterday, you remember the first talk in Spanish, there was this list of very bad passwords, right? So you can see that if you have this kind of password, you should change it right now. Right? So in 2016, what happened is that some people realized that, okay, it's funny to watch the cameras, but, well, it's not very profitable. I mean, you can watch the cameras, but you don't get any money out of it. You just spend your time. So what is this is, some of you might recognize, this is the map of internet going down on 21st of October, okay? 21st of October, like half a day or almost 1 day, whole internet or most of the internet was down in US. No Amazon, no Netflix, no Twitter, no Facebook. Oh my God, I mean, you don't have to do anything that day. Everybody was upset because you cannot just use the internet and everybody is using it for everything, to buy things, to send messages. So it was like a complete storm, right? And you can see that this complete storm or complete, like not complete, but like a huge blackout of internet was possible just by abusing like this very small list of username and password is like 68 of them, and some of them are very easy to guess. I'm not sure you can see, the list is condensed, but if you go to the Krebs on security, it has the list of these usernames and passwords and types of devices, and I can assure you that, I can assure you that most of these are IP and CCTV cameras. So the question is, like, why it's like that and why it's happening? So, and to be able to understand this, we need to take a step back and to look at the core of the problem, not just trying to change the password. I mean, how do these hackers or botnets get their thing done? How do they find these vulnerabilities, or how it's possible to attack? So now I take more like I give you the storyline to see how it's possible to bring the internet down with Internet of Things, right? And nobody, everybody was saying, yeah, it's possible, but it will not happen. It actually happened 1 month ago. So now we need to take one step back and to see the whole picture and analyze what's possible to be done and how it's done and how to protect or how to be the first to find the vulnerability so that the bad guys don't find it first. So, of course, the Internet of Things is a very abstract thing in the sense that it doesn't bring any new technology, like groundbreaking technology. It's just taking a lot of existing embedded devices, like your Fitbit or sensors, or home routers and connected headphones and smartphones, smart home systems or smart TVs. And what it just does, it just makes them a little bit smarter. Like before they were lying around, now they're making them a little bit more smarter, putting a lot of new additional and complex software inside them, like running different protocols as XML, JSON, HTTP. And all this is made just for what? To be able to connect to them, right? To query them, to get some information, and to make much richer applications. So the idea is to be able to use them in much more different ways than possible before. And most of them also provide some web interface because, as I mentioned, those small devices, but even if it's not a small device, if it's a big device like a printer, even like that is not an easy device to interact, right? It doesn't have like a big screen, doesn't have Windows operating system, doesn't have keyboard. It has some touchpad, but again, it's not the device you would love to program. And so it doesn't have like a normal web interface, it doesn't have a easy human computer interface. So most of them come with different interfaces, and most common is www or web interface, where you log in into your HTTP 192.168.0.1.1 router or printer or smart TV, right? And then you have a nice, shiny web interface where you would try to configure your password, your DNS server, maybe the MAC address of your friend to be able to log into your network or to be able to watch movies and so on. But again, the idea is that, yeah, we know that even now there's a lot of vulnerabilities in websites. I mean, and we are building websites from the 90s. It's like 27 years we are building websites, and still we have XSS and SQL. And imagine that this technology of web comes to new devices, which like they discover the web for the first time, and of course there's a lot of vulnerabilities there, or at least they are taken from existing and copy-pasted into the web. Into the embedded world. So this brings additional layer of complexity and additional layer of vulnerabilities. So at the end, the idea is that more and more devices are getting connected into this Internet of Things paradigm. And you can see that now airplanes can be more or less tracked online by using flight radar and different kinds of devices. Everything basically is connected transportation, SCADA systems, everything is just plugged into one big mess into the internet. And of course, there are multiple ways to break these devices, and there are multiple ways to protect these devices. And I'm not going to teach you all these or present all these technologies, because it would take like one semester just to present all the offensive and one all the defensive technologies. But I just give you some end-to-end example, which I personally implement or took the chance to look at, to give you an idea of how would one end-to-end quite technical approach would be. But you can take it and improve it, or you can come with a different approach. So some of the observations which we used to start the research is that first, what we did is we scanned the internet for firmware. Everybody knows what is a firmware, yeah? The firmware is basically the software which you install on embedded devices. It's the same software, but it's just a little bit different than your Windows or Linux or macOS, right? But at the end, it's some software which runs on an embedded device, like a router or printer, or camera, right, or VoIP phone. And it's called firmware for multiple historical reasons, because it's supposed to be firm, not very easy to configure or update, so it's firm, not soft, like very easy to model. But the idea is that we scan the internet for these firmwares, and you can go and download, if you buy a D-Link router, you go to D-Link.com, and you go to support page, and you get these drivers, right, and you get the firmware. And we scan the internet for these kind of files, for firmware files. Not drivers, but firmware files, which you put on the device, not on your computer. And they were, in 2013, from what we did, it was like a very shallow scan. We didn't scan all the vendors, because we don't know all the devices which exist. But in 2014, there are already around hundreds of thousands of firmware images. Okay, there's a lot of software packages to analyze, to see if they contain vulnerabilities or if they have some passwords and so on. But moreover, there's like these crazy predictions that some people take with a grain of salt or say it's true, or maybe it's over-optimistic, but these are crazy predictions that there will be like between 14, 20, 50 billion connected devices by 2020, right? So like several devices per person, per household, and so on. And actually, it could be like a very realistic scenario if you think that there's a family of two persons having like one smartphone, one smartwatch. They have also iPads, then they have two smart TVs, maybe one router. They connect like one fridge and maybe one smart cooker. And you end up already with 10 devices per two family households. So it's quite realistic in a sense that if you take five devices multiplied by 7 billion, okay, not everybody like will have, but it's kind of realistic, at least at the magnitude level, there will be billion of devices. And the thing, there are some challenges if you really want to, for example, if you really want to understand the complexity or the potential of attack or how many vulnerabilities are there, you want to take at the look at the big picture, right? You don't want to find just one small vulnerability, which is just for one particular type of watch, okay, or a smart TV. So when you have this kind of goal to take a look at the big picture, like the CCTV botnet, right? It was composed of like 68 different devices and combination of software. So it was possible because the attackers took like the big picture. They took the firmware for all those 68 devices and tried to find common vulnerabilities or different vulnerabilities and put in one big set. So the problem is that when you try to look at a large number of devices or large, as we said, billion of devices, or if you try to look at large number of firmware files, and also these devices are highly heterogeneous. One thing is a printer, which is big and has a lot of power, and another thing is a watch, which is a very small, doesn't have a lot of power and resource and battery and so on. So the difference between devices and software they can run and processors they have, and basically what we call heterogeneity is really high in embedded world, IoT. Because in classical world, you have the laptop, you have the desktop, you have the server, but they all are Intel, maybe Intel x86, you know, the processors, And maybe they have like Windows, Linux, Mac OS, like not a lot of heterogeneity, not a lot of diversity. In IoT, you have like huge heterogeneity. And they're also getting connected through different means. It's not just Ethernet or Wi-Fi. They get connected through Bluetooth, low energy, all kinds of IoT protocols, ZigBee, 802.15.4, and so on, right? And the idea is that these challenges basically prompt for kind of a different approach if you really want to see how vulnerable is the Internet of Things, or it's going to be the Internet of Things, or how to quickly find vulnerabilities. Because at the end of the day, if you are the white hat, you remember yesterday the definition, the white hat, the black hat. If you are the white hat, you want to quickly find the vulnerabilities and basically as fast as possible. You don't want to take 1 month to find one vulnerability, because the black guy, the black hat guys will basically take 1 day and will build a botnet and the internet is down, and that's bad. So these kind of challenges prompt some solution, and for example, how we approach this solution, or how we see, but of course it's just one way to approach, is because there's a lot of number of devices possible in the future, like 50 billions, we want to analyze these vulnerabilities or security without devices. Because you don't want to buy 50 billion devices, or even if you buy 100 devices, you'll not have enough space to store them, right? And then it will cost a lot of money to buy every single device just to test. So at the end of the day, the devices are running some software, and this is what we want to look at, because the software is where most of the vulnerabilities are, right? Where are the bugs which make the vulnerabilities. And we look at the software, the firmware, the so-called firmware, but again, as we mentioned, there's like hundreds of thousands. How you could possibly look at hundreds of thousands of files very quickly and like very deeply. And you basically need like very advanced and scalable architectures to check this. And then also, because the technology is so much different, like there's not just one processor, not just one operating system, you know, you need generic techniques. You cannot say, just take x86 or Intel assembly and try looking for the same in embedded, because you'll have different processors like MIPS, ARM, PowerPC, and many others we don't even know about. Okay, so how we, these are kind of the challenges and the solutions, right? We came to solve these challenges. And of course, if you take a different approach, or you come with another idea to analyze this Internet of Things, you'll have maybe additional challenges, depending the approach you take. But at least these are the challenges we took, we found in our approach, where we don't have devices and we have a lot of firmwares, and we want to do very fast analysis. So how we do this? We basically start with a list of unpacked firmware files. And how we start this, as I mentioned, in 2014, we scan the internet for many, many firmwares. We download them and just try to unpack them. What it means to unpack is basically, usually when we download a firmware, it comes as a zip file, but inside there is a very special file like .img, .fw, .upd, .something, which is basically a very specific format of software for that particular vendor or device, okay? It's like you can think of it as an Microsoft update.exe, but for that particular vendor and device, okay? And because there's a lot of devices, everybody implements his own, you need to first unpack to see what the software is inside, because it's just a wrapper, right? It's a zip file and inside is a image, but then you need to unpack. So we unpack like several thousands of these firmware files, and we have these unpack firmware source, okay? It's still binary, okay? It's not the source code, but it's the unpack firmware. And then we, for example, for a different kinds of goal, you would want to, basically, you don't want to analyze everything, because for example, if you have hundreds of thousands of firmware files, and 50,000 is for a smartwatch which doesn't have a web interface, okay? And there's another 50,000 for router which have web interface, and you want to find the vulnerabilities in the web interfaces. Then, of course, you don't need to look at the 50,000 files of the watch because it doesn't have web interface. So you need to filter out the unused data based on your goal, right? So if your goal is to look for vulnerabilities in the web interface of routers or smart TVs, you just look if there is a web server inside the firmware. Okay, how to look for a web server is, it can be as easy as looking if there's a HTTPD binary, or looking for HTML, HTTP, GET, POST, like strings. It can be different, right? You can implement even more sophisticated checks to see if a firmware has a web interface. But at the simplest thing, you can just check whether there's a binary called HTTPD, like micro HTTPD and so on. Like there's a lot of embedded web servers. It's like everybody knows Apache web server, okay? Maybe Nginx, right? So these are kind of the servers which are very heavy. They have like tons of modules. They're made for servers, but you cannot take like this 20 megabyte Apache web server and put on a device which has 6 megabytes of RAM. Okay, so it's not possible because there is not enough RAM, first of all, and you need many other programs. So there's a lot of other smaller web servers which maybe you never heard about, but you can look for them, embedded web servers, and you'll find them online. So, for example, in our case, we look for web interface bugs or web bugs in firmware, and we select these particular firmwares. Then, of course, you need to do some magic, okay? Most of the time, it will involve some kind of magic, in the sense that when you, for example, unpack a firmware file, okay? Again, as I said, unpacking is taking the zip archive from the website, taking the file from outside, from a zip file, and then trying to see what it contains. So basically taking apart different pieces. And usually you do unpacking with different tools. You can write your own, but one of the most popular is the binwalk. Everybody, how many of you know binwalk? It's called binary walker. It's take a binary, like a huge binary, and walks through every byte and looks if there's a file inside, an executable file, an image, HTML page, okay? So this unpacking is done, you know, in a very black magic way. It's unpacks the files, but is not exactly as vendor intended it to be, because the vendor doesn't give you the algorithm of the format. It doesn't give you the algorithm of the file, okay? So it's being extracted in a very like a black magic way. So when you extract this in a very hackish way, sometimes you get a lot of garbage. Sometimes you get files which are not complete, or you get files which are broken. So sometimes you need to fix this, because if you look at a broken file, you don't get the entire picture, okay? Or you maybe miss the bug because your file is not complete. So this is like the black magic but must be there, because it's not 100% accurate process when you unpack, when you do reverse engineering. It's like an approximation, okay? The reverse engineering is always an approximation to the process. And then, of course, you want to do analysis. For example, you took the firmware file, you extracted all these web server binary and the other binaries like Telnet or SSH daemon from the device. And then you want to look at different vulnerabilities. Well, of course, you want to use different techniques. Usually you will see, or you'll use static analysis techniques and dynamic analysis techniques. So the static analysis techniques, everybody's aware what it means? Okay, not so many, or you're shy guys, or it's too early in the morning, guys and girls, no? Yeah. So Basically, the static analysis is when you take a binary. It doesn't matter for which processor. It can be Intel, it can be ARM, MIPS. You take a file. It can be binary, it can be source code. And you try to find problems just by looking at it, doing some analysis, but statically, not executing the file, OK? You're running some kind of scanning on the source code or on the binary bytes, and you do static analysis. It's called static because you never run it. You don't execute it. You just look. You just look and say, I think here is a memory leak, or I think here is a memory corruption, OK? But you never execute, because to know if there is a memory corruption, you need to execute and you get segmentation fault or a crash, right? But static analysis, just by looking at it, there are different tools. But again, because it's embedded devices and different processors, there's not a lot of tools, so you need to write your own. And writing static analysis tools is not the, I mean, it's a fun job, but it's not, it doesn't guarantee you end up sane, okay? Then there's the dynamic analysis, which is basically taking a binary or a web language like PHP, Perl, Python, and basically executing it, okay? It's called dynamic analysis because you dynamically analyze or dynamically look what happens, okay? So when you do this dynamic analysis, you will find the crash or the segmentation fault, or you'll find the memory corruption. Or you can see that it's doing something shady, like maybe there's a backdoor, okay? Backdoors, for example, are particularly hard to detect in by static analysis, because you never know if it's a backdoor or it's just supposed to be like that. Maybe memory corruption is easier, but for a backdoor, it's not that easy. So, of course, we set up this kind of infrastructure in our case, where we try to do both static analysis, dynamic analysis. And you can see that you want to make it in a scalable manner, meaning that you usually will have some infrastructure and virtual machines, so you can just clone virtual machine, like thousands of virtual machine, and you will have a thousand times faster the result. But you can, of course, do on a single laptop. It's just an architecture choice. And of course, then the question arises, how, for example, you do dynamic analysis, but I'll get to this. Then you end up with these tools. Most of them are open source. They're, of course, closed source or commercial, but the commercial cost a lot of money, like thousands of US dollars or euros, and most likely, as a student or even as an independent researcher, you will not have all the money to buy this tool. So most likely you'll use open source tools, which are getting very good at this moment. I'll mention some tools at the end, which you can use, and you can take note of them. And I'm pretty sure you played with some of those tools already. Anyways, the debugger is your best friend, right? GDB or DDDDD or whatever. When you get all these kind of results and, from these tools, and you need to analyze, some of them are false positives. And this sucks, because when you have like tens of thousands of firmwares, and then you get tens of thousands of issues, and some of them are false positives, you really want only the real bugs. But the false positives is basically a fake issue. It's like a report, but is not a true vulnerability. So you have to spend time to separate or triage. And there's also techniques to overcome this, but I'll not demo this today. And of course, you use kind of this in a feedback loop to try to improve. You learn from the mistakes of the first dynamic analysis, from the first unpacking. You learn where the tools are not very efficient, and then you try to improve them, have all these bug fixes. Maybe you submit them to the GitHub and so on. Now, the question of dynamic analysis is, dynamic analysis can allow you, as I said, is the way to actually find vulnerabilities by actually executing the binary or the firmware from IoT device. And the first question is, how you actually execute a binary for your watch on your computer. I mean, your computer is not a watch. Right? how do you get there? I mean, you cannot make your computer a watch. You cannot. So to help with this, there's a technique called emulation, okay? And the emulation is the technique where you take a particular executable or code for a processor A, and you can execute or emulate this processor A on processor B, okay? So basically you have an Intel processor on your laptop, for example, and your smartphone is ARM processor. So the technique is very simple. You just have an emulator on your laptop or on your server, which runs on Intel, but the emulator knows how to execute each byte of the ARM processor, okay? So it's called emulation. And this emulation now is really well understood, and there's a lot of tools, but the most well known is the QEMU. I mean, for example, when you run a virtual machine, right, who use VirtualBox, Oracle VirtualBox, everybody, who use VMware, everybody. So this is also an emulation, right? Is a kind of, there's some code which can emulate your 32-bit processor on a 64-bit machine, but is only basically an emulation of the same kind of processor. VirtualBox and VMware gives you like Intel to Intel. It's just, but it's still emulation. But with QEMU, for example, you can run ARM code on Intel PC, because QEMU is quite versatile. It has like 10 to 20 architectures, different processors. You can run everything on Intel or on a Raspberry Pi. Basically, you can compile everything to everything, okay? So we, and it's also open source, so if there's any bug, you can fix or contribute and add another processor, which you like, for example, and is not there. So we use QEMU, but a lot of our researchers use QEMU, so it's one way to go forward. It's pretty well understood. Now, how do you actually, then comes the question of how do you actually emulate a device which you don't know anything about, or maybe you know a lot about, but how do you actually emulate? And there's a lot of ways to emulate devices. First is the ideal or the perfect emulator, okay, which is basically you take a firmware and you can emulate everything as if it was running on the router or on your watch, but you emulate it perfectly in your computer. So we call it the ideal emulator. We don't know that such a thing exists, where you just give it a firmware and it will emulate everything perfectly from the first time without asking any questions, and it just runs, okay? So it's kind of idealistic way where we want to reach as community or as researchers, but we are not there. It's kind of, you know, Skynet, artificial intelligence and all that, which will be able to do that. Then there's the generic system emulation, where you take the original firmware you download from the website, okay, and the original kernel. And at the same time, you can use the original firmware, but not with the original kernel, but with a kernel you compile your own, okay? You can compile your own kernel. Did anybody compile your own Linux kernel? Okay, it's fun, you should try it, it's not painful, it runs pretty fast, so you can always try it. You can compile for Intel, you can compile for ARM, MIPS, for everything. So you can all, so the kernel is basically the core of the operating system, for example, in Windows, Linux, right? Most of the operating systems. So most of these devices are Linux-based, so you can compile your own kernel. And why is good sometimes to compile your own kernel is because you can put more debugging information in the kernel. Okay, and what does it mean, more debugging information? It means that you can find faster or better the bugs, the crashes, the hints about memory corruption or something going wrong. When you use the original kernel, you don't know how it was compiled, and maybe it's without debug information, so you'll not get too much details about possible vulnerabilities when you do dynamic analysis and emulation, okay? Then there's some other types of emulation. For example, hosted emulation is where you don't use any kind of emulation, and it's mostly for web interfaces like Perl and PHP, where you take the PHP files from your router and you put on an Apache web server. So on a router, it runs PHP on a BOA web server, but you take the PHPs and you put on your laptop on Apache, because it's PHP, it will run, and you can find vulnerabilities there. So, but it doesn't work for other types of vulnerabilities or processes. For binary, it doesn't work that way. You cannot take a binary from your router and put on your computer and execute. It will not run because it's different processor, different architecture. Now, I'll just quickly try to explain. Well, we don't have a perfect emulator. There is no such thing, at least not as we know it. Maybe NSA and things like that, they have it, or a lot of money if you have. Maybe they exist, but not publicly. Then the original firmware with original kernel. As I said, original kernel, you don't know how it was compiled. It doesn't have debug information. And worse, most of the time, when you download the firmware or you try to analyze, you'll not have the kernel. They always just ship you the binaries, not the kernel. And the kernel, you need to extract it from the device, from memory. And it's not easy to do all the time. So basically, we use this original firmware, which is basically, let's say, the web interface, and our own kernel, where we built a lot of debugging information, and we can debug it and control it better in the emulator. Now, very, very simple and fast overview of how this how it looks like in a setup way, and then I'll show you a demo. So basically, you can have it on a host, or you can have it on a virtual machine. And inside you have this QEMU, right? If you go to QEMU.org, you'll find this emulator. You can download it, you can compile it yourself. It's also very simple. And then inside this QEMU, what we have? We have this Linux kernel, which we can compile ourselves, as I mentioned. We compile it. And then there is the Debian user space. What it means is that it's basically a Debian distribution. Everybody knows Debian. It's kind of Ubuntu, yeah? I'm making it easier, you know, just. It's basically a distribution, right? A Linux distribution. So the advantage is that there's a lot of effort to make Debian work on different operating on different processors, so you can install it on routers or whatever you want. And the idea is that when using this kind of setup, the Debian comes with a lot of existing tools like debugger, network analyzers, all kinds of utilities which help you to debug or to find the vulnerabilities like memory analysis and debugger and so on. So we use this Debian, and then the many other researchers, what also they do or what they propose is to take the firmware files and we put it inside this Debian. It's like copying the files, right? And then we use chroot. Do you know what chroot means? No? So basically, yeah, some of you know. So basically, changing it's kind of a jail route. You have an application or a kind of a path, and you want the application inside this path not to see the rest of the partition or the root file system. You want to limit as if it sees just a sub partition or sub, yeah? So why it's good and why it works? Well, you put a firmware in a temporary folder, for example, and then you chroot, and the firmware will not see Debian. We'll see just as if it's only the firmware inside, okay? Because you do chroot, okay? Is it clear how it works? So then, of course, once you chroot, you can run all the processes and initialize and start the web server. And we do this by, you can look what kind of web server is there, and then you know the parameters how to start it, or you just call the linuxrc or init script, right? Everybody knows linuxrc and init scripts, and it will do everything itself. And then what we do, we come with these really nice tools from outside of QEMU, like everybody knows Nmap, Metasploit, Nessus. It's kind of testing tools, penetration tools, vulnerability assessment tools. And there are others, web penetration tools, which allows to try to attack network interfaces inside the emulator, okay? Because the emulator starts, it opens all the ports and so on. If it has a web server, it will open port 80. If it has SSH server, it will open port 22. If it has Telnet, port 23. And then emulator opens these ports to the outside, right? And then you can use these tools as if you use on a normal router or a normal network system, right? You use these tools in a way on a real device, you can use the same on an emulated device, okay? Yeah, it's clear? Okay, so some of these tools, maybe some of you are familiar. For example, ZAP is a Z-Attack proxy from OWASP, no? And there's Arachne, also different kind of tool, different kind of languages. Some of them are in Python, some of them are in Ruby, but nevertheless, they're open source. You can fix them, you can improve them or add modules, write your own. So this is basically the general approach how you do this. And it works pretty well. Well, I mean, it doesn't work perfectly, of course. We, for example, did some experiments. We started with almost 2,000 firmwares, but at the end, we ended up being able to emulate 500 of them. And sometimes the emulation failed because there is, when you do the emulation, you miss some drivers. So the emulator doesn't know how to emulate a particular device or doesn't have the driver. For example, if there is some memory, like NAND memory, or some ROM, or some serial device, or for example, if you try to emulate a CCTV camera, you don't have a video input device. The emulator doesn't know about this. So sometimes the emulation fails, sometimes it works. So I mean, it's kind of best effort. It's always, you have a feedback loop, you always improve. And then we also had the web server started okay. We are looking for vulnerabilities in web server, particularly in this case, but the same approach you can use for vulnerabilities in SSH, in Telnet, in UPnP, in all the other network services, right? You all know very well, FTP and so on. And we have been able to emulate like 500, and then the web server is up in 250. Then we also saw that majority of the devices or the firmwares we try to emulate or analyze are ARM and MIPS, like the biggest. But then there's Axis Chris. How many of you know Axis Chris? Well, there's a company called Axis, and it does CCTV cameras, against CCTV cameras. And basically, they do a particular processor, which is called Chris. And there's a lot of firmwares on this architecture. So knowing how to emulate it is also helps to find bugs in these CCTV cameras. Then we also, because we look at the web servers, we look at the mini, what kind of web servers are there. And we found that LightHTTPD and MiniHTTPD and a little bit of BOA is present. So it gives you an idea of what kind of software is there. And why it's useful, for example, to fingerprint what kind of software is there or their version is that, because if you know it's running BOA, when you go to the BOA website and look what vulnerabilities does it have or what CVE does it have, and then you can try to just execute those CVEs to get the exploit running to be able to confirm if it has a vulnerability or not, okay? Then there's all kinds of other network services which are started. You see some devices start DNS server, Telnet server, the SSH server, and so on. Some of them start the RTSP, real-time streaming protocol. So many of these are kind of CCTV cameras or network video recorders. so all they stream video. It can be also media centers, which also stream video on these ports, right? So again, you can use a particular fuzzer or particular tool to analyze RTSP vulnerabilities, because it also contains vulnerabilities, not just the web, not just the telnet. Okay? So we focused on web vulnerabilities, and we found by using static analysis and dynamic analysis. So by using static analysis, you can see that in static analysis, you'll get reports with 10,000 problems. I mean, it's really hard to take a look at every one of these problems. It's the false positive problem, where you get a lot of reports, but you don't know for sure whether it's a real bug or not, because it's static. It just looks and it tries to say, I think there's a vulnerability, but it's not sure. So we find a lot of cross-site scripting and command execution in many firmwares. But then what we do, we also, because we emulate, we can do the dynamic analysis, right? Because the web server is running, we can use the ZAD tool or Arachne tool and actually try to do some web penetration testing. How many of you did some web penetration testing, some SQL injection, some, right? You know the tools, you just give the IP or the IP and URL, and it will do it for you, and it will tell that this URL with these input or parameters is XSS or command injection or SQL. So we did the same, but instead of putting a URL of a web server, we put the URL of emulator, okay? But the concept is the same, it's kind of black box. And we also find, confirm also command execution, cross-site scripting, CSRF in many firmwares, and these ones are kind of for real, in the sense that it's also confirmed, because on the emulator it gets executed, okay? In the static analysis, is like, yeah, you need to check every of those 10,000. These 225 here, is like real issues, real problems, like real vulnerabilities. Then you can find different other vulnerabilities. For example, one problem is that when you look at firmwares of Internet of Things, again, is like huge thing. There's a lot of devices, a lot of vendors, a lot of firmware version. You never know whether two devices have the same bug or not, whether the device comes from the same vulnerability from the same vendor or not, and so on. So sometimes the CVE or the vulnerability, okay? For example, if you look at this vulnerability, it's 2011, right? And when it was open, it used to say that it's open for WNIP 2110 device, right? It's a particular like router and thing. And it says that you can bypass authentication. Basically, you don't need to know the password, but you can still log in as admin to the router and do the admin things. The thing is that because the one who found this vulnerability, maybe he had only this device at his home, he found the vulnerability and report, but he didn't look at our devices because he didn't buy the device or didn't use the large-scale emulation, okay? Now, because we look at the large-scale emulation, we also have firmware for different devices, and we can check this vulnerability if it's true. And, for example, you can see it's a WNAP 2110. Let me just try to see. I hope it works. No, just 1 second. So what's happening, you see I have this virtual machine here, right? It's a VMware, and you see that this VMware is running, and it's running on this IP. Well, you can take my word for it, I mean. And you can see that I'm using this weird port 2080. So basically it's kind of a port redirect, it doesn't matter. So it reaches actually the port 80 in the firmware itself, okay? And you can see that I don't have any Netgear WG103 router. It's not here, but it's running, right? It's running in the emulator. I don't need the device to be able to find the vulnerability or confirm, right? Exactly as I was telling you. So the idea is that first, if I try to log in as admin or admin, well, it doesn't work, let's say, for different reasons. It could be that the password is different, or maybe the emulation is not perfect, okay? Yeah, you never know. That's another, you look at the logs, that's why you have these debuggers and a kernel you built. You look at the logs after and you improve. But what I was trying to explain is that, you see, it's a WG103, and this WG103, is not WNAP2110, but if I try to use the exploit from this device, let's see if it works. Recreate, okay. Well, we don't know what it means, but the exploit says we need just to access, I mean, the original CV says we need to access this URL. We enter, oh, we're logged in, right? So you see that basically you can confirm existing bugs, and you can also look at, wow, it's not just this device, but it's this, but oh, it's this. And the problem is because it's one vendor, but sometimes the vendors, actually, they put their label, but they buy in Asian country, and you have label A, label B, label C, for example, Netgear, D-Link, but inside is the same device. So you can say that, it affects D-Link, and I have Netgear, but you also can be affected because of these kind of problems, right? And it's an idea to look at the big picture. So it was one example. Another example, you can, for example, let me try to see. There is no password, right? But let me just execute some. So basically, you can see that we found some PHP file which has command execution. Okay. Again, in the emulator, there is no password file, right? Now I run this kind of exploit, okay? And you can see the exploit is command injection, and it does copy etc password, and I'll not copy to the TMP of the emulator, I'll copy it to the home, www. And you know the classical things of command injection, you use the command, okay, update success, whatever. And then you just look at password. Oh, okay, great. Let's open it. And we can see that you get the password of the device. So the emulator like helps you to play with the device without having the device and actually find these kind of vulnerabilities like command injection, the same existing exploit applied to different devices and so on. So it's kind of a very versatile. Well, and everything is software. If it doesn't work, you just reboot the virtual machine. You don't have to unplug, reset router, something like that, and so on. So it's very, you know, you can do everything in a chill way. and it affects a lot of devices, and you can look at the site, at the vulnerabilities list, which we discovered using this kind of approach. And there's the XSS and command injection. I just gave you like a simple example of command injection, but you can check more on the website. It used to be like a 0 day, and all these will be in the slides, which you can download later. Is no, well, if you want to take pictures, but it will be there. And basically, we find these kind of vulnerabilities. You saw in a very quick way. And of course, it's not perfect, but there's always room to improve. And we have a lot of dynamic tools, alerts, and static analysis tool alerts. The count is not important. What is important is the big picture. You can have one single CVE, but if you can map it to all the possible devices and firmware version, then it's already a good start. You don't need like a lot of reports. But again, doing some manual triage and confirmation of these vulnerabilities is still kind of, is not an easy topic. Sometimes you have a report of vulnerability, but to confirm it is very hard. It's not as easy as accessing an URL if it's a more complex exploit or vulnerability. Now, the idea of this talk was to give you like, up till now, to give you the big picture, how you would do this and why you need to look at the big picture, and how easy it is to use the emulation, and how actually this is one of the ways you can approach the Internet of Things security, because you cannot buy all the Apple Watches, Android Watch, this router. You don't have enough money, you don't have enough space to store this, and you can also break them, and what you do, you have to send them back, is a problem. But the idea is, now let's look forward. I mean, we understand that there's a lot of vulnerabilities, there's no doubt. I mean, there's be 50 billion devices, most likely, most of them will have at least one vulnerability, two, maybe even more. And there's like hundreds of thousands of firmwares. But the idea is that we saw with Mirai attack, like the CCTV botnet, we saw that the attackers are already using these vulnerabilities like at large scale in the wild. And usually the goal of security is to bring some protection, some countermeasures, something to protect. Yeah, attacking is easy, but well, we need to protect at least as white hats. This is what we try to do. So one way forward is to use IoT honeypots. What it means is basically you can use very simple honeypots on the internet, maybe in your campus or in your own home network. What is a honeypot? Is basically a fake device or a fake server. Okay, it doesn't even need to be a virtual machine or a service. It just opens the network service as if it runs on a real device, like Telnet 23. It's just a simple, you know, client server. You just open something on port 23 and give back whatever the malware expects. It's called honeypot because it makes the malware think is a real device and it tries to infect, and then you can study the malicious files. And there's some examples of honeypots you can go right now and download. They're easy to set up. You can set up them on your Linux, Windows machine or virtual machine and so on. And it's really, was really useful to understand this kind of CCTV botnet attack recently, okay? So there are people who release this. You can develop your own and contribute. So this is one way forward, to set up the honeypots to understand what is the, how is malware being running, okay? Then the goal of honeypots is to catch as much malware as possible. And then, well, if you catch malware and it is there, it's not useful. You really want to understand what malware does. I mean, the malware, what it does, first, exploit vulnerability, right? Maybe it's a hard-coded password, maybe it's a memory corruption, command execution, and so on. So it contains some kind of zero day or exploit or vulnerability. So if you have the malware, you can understand what is the vulnerability or exploit. And you need to analyze to understand. And second, because you'll analyze, you'll know how to protect your devices, your network, so that you don't get infected in real devices. The honeypot is okay, is kind of, anyway, it's fake. But the real devices is, if you run a campus network with CCTV cameras I saw here, you really don't want these devices to be part of the botnet, so you want to take protection. So the another way forward is to do malware analysis, but again, it's not easy because, well, there's different processors, different software, different kind of, it's a different world. Of course, there are tools, as I mentioned, QEMU, there's the Debian ports project. There's the Radare 2. There'll be a talk tomorrow on Radare 2 reverse engineering. So I recommend you to attend. It's a very cool framework. There's the IDA Pro. How many of you use IDA Pro? Not many because it's expensive, or if you use, well, okay. And there's different other open source frameworks like Unicorn, Capstone, and Keystone. These kind of are different disassembly engines or emulation engines which help you to understand the ARM MIPS binary code. And of course, the first thing, the very next thing which I advise you to do is, once you have this QEMU running, for example, for ARM and MIPS, then you just go and maybe you don't have, you are not likely to catch malware with your honeypot, but you can start analyzing existing malware because somebody already caught it, right? So there is a lot of malware resources. Like the PsyBot, it was like 2009, is the first router botnet, and I recommend you to go and take a look. It used to affect some Linksys routers. Then there is the Moonworm in 2014, used to kind of also infect Linksys routers, but in a different way. Then the new variation or the old variation of Hydra or Aedra or different names is a denial of service botnet targeting mainly MIPS and ARM devices. There is the Mirai, the very infamous one, which took down the internet. And you can also get the source code because the author posted it online, but you can also get the binaries. And of course, you get the binaries, you can run them in QEMU, is an emulator. You can always kill, there is no risk of infection. I mean, if you play safe. Then there is NeaDrop. I provide you all these links, so you just can go and download. It's open, it's public, publicly available. Just download Git clone, and you can start playing and analyzing, start learning about these new IoT malware, new IoT threats. NeaDrop is targeting, you see, it checks the CPU info, so it targets a particular, if I'm not mistaken, MIPS, okay? And there's other malware, which is higher level, like LuaBot. It uses some scripting languages and encryption and so on. So there's some more malware which I couldn't find easy to download, but if you look up the articles, maybe you can find some Dropbox where you can download, like the Karna, the Rain Karna, the eForge. For example, the Internet Census, the first big analysis of IPv4 space was done with a non-malicious botnet. So I think it's time for me to conclude. So the takeaways from this talk or from this presentation, what I would like you to convey is that the large-scale firmware analysis is basically absolutely necessary, especially with IoT hype, because otherwise you cannot feasibly analyze like 50 billion devices, 100,000 firmwares, and of course there's a lot of challenges. And you could see that dynamic analysis, like emulation and all these techniques, they really work. I mean, it's not just some obscure technique. It works pretty well. I demonstrate to you how you can really find or check existing vulnerabilities. And it also looks like many of these IoT vendors or embedded devices vendors, they don't do basic QA or basic testing. I mean, if you do the basic testing, you would code this kind of bugs like in half a day. If you look at the PHP code, you catch them in 2 minutes. If you use the simplest open source tool, you don't need to buy expensive one, you still find them. So it means that, I don't know, maybe they don't do testing, so if you go and work for somebody, just say them, we need to do testing. I mean, it's not possible otherwise. And of course, the good thing is that now, with this Mirai botnet and the internet going down because of the Internet of Things, I mean, it's kind of ironical that internet goes down because of Internet of Things, just leave the things inside. The high attention to this problem is there, and a lot of researchers contribute, and the honeypots are more available. You can contribute your own honeypot, or you can quickly download somebody else's honeypot and start quickly to analyze. And also the malware samples are more accessible, and very well explained in different blog posts or analysis, and you can quickly learn how what are the malware techniques for IoT, because in general they have similar direction as laptop or server malware, but it will use different techniques and different kinds of ways because of the interconnection is different and the protocols are different, ZigBee, Bluetooth, and so on. And yeah, finally, the IoT malware analysis is interesting and useful. It can reveal like the 0 days and exploits used. I would like to thank my my colleagues and professors, which also helped me a lot during my PhD, where I did this research. And I actually invite you to read the full white papers and take a look at the vulnerabilities and links and resources. And a lot of links for you to just go and download the tools or play with the tools. There's a lot of tools you can use. Beanwalk, binary analysis, all kinds of scanners, and penetration testing tools. And of course, these are the online search engines where you can go and check if your web camera or your printer is online or your neighbor's printer is online, I don't know. But be careful. Thank you. If you have any questions, I don't know if we have time, but if you have time for some questions, if not, I'll be here around. You can always approach. Yeah, thank you. I think there's a microphone.
Check.
Well, I don't know if.
Yes, thank you. My question was regarding backdoors already implemented inside the devices. For instance, I guess the most common case would be Windows 10. What it does is constantly sends information, data about our computer towards Windows. And I would like to know what's the vulnerability that we have if someone were to hack the data flow, for instance.
Many of these devices, even now, I mean, some of these devices like routers or ADSL modems, or they send all kinds of information already. Sometimes they send to the vendor, so it's kind of already kind of a backdoor. Now it depends what information they send. Is it privacy infringing information, or if it's kind of anonymized, just statistics or maintenance information, it could be okay. But usually from the practice, yes, they don't do proper anonymization. Now, of course, there could be like real backdoors, like not just sending some information, but real backdoors, like in Juniper case, where there was like big switches which run in telecommunication and banks. And there was a backdoor where you could like log in remotely with special key. This is hard to tell, hard to find, but still it's possible to find if you look at the firmware, or if you look at the documentation and release notes, they will say security fix and no details. Then it means there's some shady things. But again, you actually need to play, at least you need to look at the firmware. At least statically, you need to look what files it contains, what strings, what kind of information or code it contains. And of course, try to monitor some traffic from the emulated device or from real device to try to see what's incoming or what's outgoing. But I'm not sure if it answers your question exactly.
Well, my question would be, what would be the best technique to, I guess, secure our already built-in backdoors that we have in most of our devices?
Okay, so you have you build a backdoor in a device you want to secure, so nobody finds it?
No. What I'm referring is basically, another case was the FBI asked Apple to find an exploit in their phones so they could hack them basically and check if that person was doing something malicious or anything.
This kind of backdoors.
Yes, but those things are not installed by virus or a malicious program, they are already built. When they come out of the store, they already have this backdoor built in.
Yeah, exactly.
What can we users do to prevent people from looking at our data?
As users, I don't think you can do much, but as security researchers, well, I hope everybody is security researcher at least by night, if not by day. Okay. What we can do is actually try to look at these devices physically or in emulation. Okay. Try to take every piece of this code which runs on them. Okay. And look at it. I mean, if there is not available a disassembler, decompiler, write one. Okay. Or write a tool which can correlate some information and say, look, this looks like a backdoor. Like contribute with the tools. I mean, it's hard to tell what you can do. As a user, basically, there's nothing you can do because it's not obvious to you, because it's not even obvious to security researchers that there is a backdoor. But by looking or emulating these kind of devices or actually playing with a device, you can see this abnormal behavior, and then you can dig deeper. But backdoors are tricky. Sometimes they are not even in software, as you said. They're inside the chip. Okay, they're inside the hardware, and then is even more dangerous and game over. And there were cases where Cambridge researchers showed that there's some chips which are installed in U.S. military systems but built in China. There have backdoors, but yeah, we can take it offline. And I.
Okay, we are a little bit it's a tight schedule plan. Thank you, Mr. Costin.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you.
But if you friends have any more questions for Dr. Costin, we'll have a coffee break soon. We'll announce it during the talks, so you may be talking with the speakers and that. Also do. To our schedule. Now we will have a talk from Mr. Soria from Telefonica. Good news for our attendees. The talk will be in Spanish, but it will be the only talk in Spanish for today. All the following talks will be in English. So give a big applause to Mr. Soria. As he comes from Telefonica, one of our main partners, people who made this event actually possible, along with Vector ETC. Also during this day, we'll be announcing some kind of lottery. So you may have the opportunity to win a beer pack. We'll be announcing that during the day. I won't tell you exactly when, so you have to stay. And I also be announcing some things, some funny things during the day. One of them is that now if you go to the main table during the coffee break, you will get a sticker of the con with, you know, this logo. So you can get stickers then at 11. At the main desk in the hall. So now we'll have the talk of Mr. Soria, and then we'll have a talk about hacking in the game industry by Mr. Josep Balbors.